Hey there, my name's Kelly, and I'm the stay-at-home astronaut. Welcome to my channel! Today I'm going to show you how I create my carved platters using GR Pottery Forms. I'm using a Cone 6 mid-fire clay called Speckled Brownstone from Highwater Clays. I'm going to cut a little less than half of this 25-pound block to use to create my slab. After cutting off what I need, I bring it to the slab roller and I want to throw out the first part of my slab. I'm going to do this by picking up the block of clay and throwing the flat part at the table so as it lands, it elongates itself across the surface. I'll alternate the sides that I'm throwing it until it gets more of a flat shape. Then I'll start rolling it out through the slab roller. Throwing it first, though, allows me to have a little more control over the shape of the slab. From here, I'll cover up my clay with the canvas and remove the inserts from the slab roller. Removing and adding these boards as I go allows me to get the slab shape and thickness that I need. If you don't have a slab roller in your studio, you can use a rolling pin and boards to adjust the thickness. Now I'll start smoothing and compressing my slabs with a rubber rib from Mud Tools. I like to use their yellow rib, which is stiff, but it still has a little bit of flex in it. Once that side's done, I'll flip the slab over and compress on the other side. And once that side's compressed, it's back through the slab roller. And then I'll repeat this process a few more times until I have my clay slab to the thickness I want it to be, which is about half an inch. Clay tends to have a memory, so the more directions you roll it in and the more you compress it, the less likely your piece is to warp or crack. As you can tell, it's a pretty repetitive process, but the time put in now makes it so much more worth it in the end. Sometimes when clay slabs get larger, they're hard to flip. So a tip to make that easier is to roll it out with a piece of cloth underneath. So that way when you go to flip it, you have support underneath it and it makes the whole slab a little more manageable. I didn't do that here because the piece wasn't quite that big. Now that my clay slab is to the size that I want, I'll start laying out my GR pottery forms to make sure that I have the room that I need. Once I see that they'll fit, I'm going to fold the edge back and slide the piece underneath where I want it to be. And then I'll repeat with the other side. Next, I'll gently press the clay around the form, and then I'll start to smooth the clay over the surface and begin cutting out the rough shape of the platter. I saved my scraps from this part so that I can use the foot tool from GR to create the feet for the bottom of these platters. Now I'm going to mark out where I want my feet to sit, and I'll start slipping and scoring those sections, as well as the bottom part of the feet, so that way I can get a good connection. Thank you. Then I'll move them to a ware board made from drywall and allow them to sit covered for a day or two to let the clay become leather hard. This way the form can be removed and I can begin carving after smoothing out the feet and adding my stamp. Now that the piece has sat a few days and has become leather hard, it's no longer as malleable as it was fresh out of the bag. This means I can go in with my sponge and smooth out any rough spots, as well as go in and add my stamp and not have to worry about knocking off any of the edges that I want to keep. Here I'm taking my Dolan knife and cutting off excess clay, that way my shape is more uniform. Now that the platter is smooth and to the shape that I want, I'll lightly trace out the design that I want to carve onto the surface. Since I'm partially doing a sgraffito technique, I'm going to add white underglaze to the areas that I'm carving. For this piece, I'm using Speedball's white underglaze. Now that the underglaze is dried, I'm going to go back in and begin to carve out the mountains. Here I'm adding trees, and then I'll go back in and remove the clay above them to help them stand out more against their background. Now I'm going to clean up any excess underglaze that's outside the lines and then go back in and start defining the edges. Now that the mountains are the way that I want them, I'm going to go back in and start adding some defining shapes to the moon's surface so that way it stands out more. Thank you. Now that my moon's finished, I'm going to go back in and start adding texture to the mountains using a tool that's shaped like a rake. I'm alternating between light and heavy stippling to create the bends and folds of the mountainside. Now that the interior surface is done, I need to work on the rim to draw your eye into the piece. Here I'm using a wire tool to mark out even sections of the rim. Then once that's done, I'll use a Dolan knife with a broken tip to mimic the look of stitches on the surface. And now I'm going to get a stencil and add that pattern around the edges to mimic a quilt. And it's done. Just kidding, I just gotta touch up a few more spots. Now I'm going to add some stars and constellations to the sky. Then I'll take my underglaze and fill in the spots of the stars and then gently scrape away any excess. And now it's done. Or well, for the most part, there's a couple more steps. Now this piece has to dry for about a week or so, and then it goes into the kiln for its first firing, which is called a bisque firing. This firing goes to cone 04, or 1945 degrees. This makes the clay hard enough that I can't change the surface, and dry enough that it'll soak up the glaze that I'm gonna add to it. I don't want my piece to stick to the kiln shelf, so I'm going to add liquid latex to the feet and allow it to dry. Adding liquid latex allows me to mask off areas that I don't want glaze to go, so that way it's an easy cleanup. You can also use a wax resist for this part, but I just like the latex. Once my latex is dry, I'm going to coat my piece with 2 to 3 coats of Spectrum's transparent glaze. Once the glaze is dry, I'll go back in and peel the latex off the feet and then flip it over and add 2 to 3 coats of the clear glaze to the front. Now it's time to load it for its final firing. I fired a cone 6, which is 2,232 degrees. And now a day later, it's finally time to see the finished piece. I've titled this piece Appalachian Nights, and I'm incredibly proud of how it turned out. Thanks for watching. I really hope you enjoyed this video. Be sure to subscribe, hit that thumbs up button, and ring that bell icon so you can know when I upload my next video. Also, comment down below. Let me know what you thought of this video, and let me know what you would like to see me make in the future.